Good afternoon. Thank you for coming. I am Cade Hill, the director. And before we begin, I'd like to thank a few people. First, John Middleton Cox, our producer and fantastic lighting designer. Maureen Krebs, our costume designer. Peter Waldron, our carpenter and set designer. Vanessa Ovian, who's done fantastic work publicizing the show. And two students, Neil Bomber and Mark Chowinski, who produced the music you're going to hear in the show. And last but certainly not least, John Porter, who's done a fantastic job upgrading the lighting and sound system in this auditorium for us. I want to thank this cast and crew for making this the most fun production I've ever been a part of. I've told them that backstage. I'm not sure if they believe me, but I'm saying it now, so now they have to believe me. Please don't be afraid to laugh, to clap. They want to hear you. They want to know you appreciate everything they're doing for you. Please enjoy our production of Twelfth Night. Thank you.
Play on, give me excess of it, that surfeiting the appetite may sicken and so die. And that strain again it had a dying fall, it came over mine eyes like the sweet sound that reads upon a violet bank of violets stealing and giving odor. Enough, no more, 'tis not so sweet now as it was before.
Will you go hunt, my lord?
What, curio?
The heart.
Why, so I do the noblest that I have. When mine eyes did see Olivia's first, me thought she purged the air of pestilence. At that instant was I turned into a heart. Okay. How now, what news from her?
So please, my lord, I might not be admitted, but from her handmaid do return this answer. The element itself, till 7 years' heat, shall not behold her face at ample view. She will veiled walk, and water once a day her chamber round with eye-offending brine. All this to season a brother's dead love, which she would keep fresh and lasting in her sad remembrance.
She that hath a heart of that fine frame, to pay this debt of love but to a brother, how will she love when this rich golden shaft hath killed the flock of all affections else that live in her? Away before me to sweet beds of flowers, love thoughts lie rich when canopied with bowers.
What country, friend, is this?
This is Illyria, lady.
And what should I do in Illyria? My brother, he is in Elysium. Perchance he is not drowned. What think you, sailor?
It is perchance that you yourself were saved. Assure yourself. I saw your brother, most provident in peril, bind himself to a strong mast that lived upon the sea.
Knowest thou this country?
Aye, madam, for I was born and bred.
Who governs here?
A noble duke, in nature as in name.
What is the name?
Orsino.
Orsino. I have heard my father name him. He was a bachelor then.
And so is now, or was so very late. For he does seek the love of the fair Olivia.
What's she?
A virtuous maid, the daughter of a count that died some 12 months since. Then leaving her in the protection of her son, her brother, who shortly also died. They say for whose dear love she hath abjured the company and sight of men. She will admit no kind of suit, no, not the duke's.
There is a fair behavior in thee, captain. I prithee, and I'll pay thee bounteously. Conceal me what I am. I'll serve this duke. Thou shalt present me as a eunuch to him. It may be worth thy pains, for I can sing and speak to him in many sorts of music that will allow me very worth his service. What else hap to time I will commit? Only shape thou silence to my wit.
Be you his eunuch and your mute I'll be.
I thank thee. Lead me on.
What a plague means my niece to take the death of her brother thus? I am sure care. It's an enemy to life.
By my troth, Sir Toby, you must come in earlier nights. Your cousin, my lady, takes great exceptions in your ill hours. You must confine within the modest limits of order.
Confine? I'll confine myself no finer than I am. These clothes are good enough to drink in, and so be these boots, too.
That coughing and drinking will undo you. I heard my lady talk of it yesterday, and of a foolish knight you brought in here one night to be her wooer.
Who, Sir Andrew Aguecheek?
Aye, he.
Why, he's as tall a man as any's in Illyria.
What's that to the purpose?
He has 3,000 ducats a year.
Aye, but he'll have but a year in all these ducats. He's a very fool and a prodigal.
Fie, that you'll say so.
Besides that, he's a great quarreler, and but that he hath the gift of a coward. Tis thought among the prudent he would quickly have the gift of a grave.
By this hand, they are scoundrels and subtractors that say so of him.
They that add, moreover, he struck nightly in your company.
With drinking healths to my niece, I will drink to her as long as there is a passage in my throat, and drink in Illyria. He's a coward and a knave that will not drink to my niece. Ah, here comes Sir Andrew Agueface.
Sir Toby Belt.
How now, Sir Toby Andrew.
Bless you, fair shrew.
And to you, sir.
Accost, Sir Andrew, accost.
What's that?
My niece's chambermaid.
Good mistress, accost. I desire a better acquaintance.
My name is Mary, sir.
Good mistress, Mary, accost.
You mistake, knight. Accost is front her, board her, woo her, assail her.
By my troth, I would not undertake her in this company. Is that the meaning of accost?
Fare you well, gentlemen.
Fair lady, do you think you have fools in hand?
Sir, I have not you by the hand.
Marry, but you shall have, and here's my hand.
Now, sir, I pray thee, thought is free. Bring your hand to the buttery bar and let it drink.
Wherefore, sweetheart? What's your metaphor?
It's dry, sir.
Why, I think so. I'm not such an ass, but I can keep my hand dry. But what's your jest?
A dry jest, sir.
Are you full of them?
Aye, sir. I have jests at my fingers' ends, but I let go your hand and... I am barren.
Ah! Oh, knight, thou lackest a cup of canary. When did I see thee so put down?
I'll home tomorrow, Sir Toby.
Oh, pourquoi, my dear knight?
What is pourquoi? Do or not do? I would I had bestowed that time in the tongues that I had in fencing, dancing, and berry baiting. Oh, had I but followed the arts.
Then hadst thou had an excellent head of hair.
Why would that have mended my hair?
Well, pass question, for thou seest it will not curl by nature. Huh?
But it becomes me well enough. Dost not?
Excellent. It hangs like flax on a distaff, and I hope to see a housewife take thee between her legs and spin it off.
I'll ride home tomorrow, Sir Toby. Your niece will not be seen. The Count himself here hard by woos her.
She'll none of the Count. She'll not match above her degree. Neither in estate, years, nor wit, I have heard her swear it.
I'll stay a month longer. Ah. I'm a fellow of the strangest mind in the world. I delight in masks and revel sometimes altogether.
Oh, well, what is thy excellence in a galliard, knight?
Faith, I can cut a caper.
Oh, and I can cut the mutton to it. Wherefore do these gifts have a curtain before them? I did think, by the excellent constitution of thy leg, it was formed under the star of Galliard.
Aye, 'tis strong and does indifferent well in a flame-colored stock. Shall we set about some bevels?
Oh, what shall we do else? Were we not born under Taurus?
Taurus, that's sides and heart.
Oh, no, sir, it is legs and thighs. Let me see the caper. Oh. Higher.
Oh-ho!
Excellent! Oh-ho-ho! Come on!
If the Duke continues these favors towards you, Cesario, your life should be much advanced. He hath known you but 3 days, and already you are no stranger.
Who saw Cesario?
On your attendance, my lord, here.
Stand you a while aloof, Cesario. Thou knowest no less but all. I've unclasped to thee the book even of my secret soul. Therefore, good youth, address thy gait unto her. Be not denied access. Stand at her doors and tell them. There thy fixed foot shall grow till thou have audience.
Sure, my noble lord, if she be so abandoned to her sorrow as it is spoke, she will never admit me.
Be clamorous and leap all civil bounds, rather than make unprofited return.
Say I do speak with her, my lord, what then?
and then unfold the passion of my love. Surprise her with discourse of my dear faith. She will attend it better in thy youth than in a nuncio's of more grave aspect.
I think not so, my lord.
Dear lad, believe it, for they shall yet belie thy happy years. That say thou art a man. Diana's lip is not more smooth and rubious, and thy small pipe is as the maiden's organ shrill and sound, and all the semblance of a woman's part. Prosper well in this, and thou shalt live as freely as thy lord to call his fortunes thine.
I'll do my best to woo your lady. And yet, a baleful strife, whoever I woo myself would be his wife.
You will be hanged for being so long absent. Let her hang me, then.
He that is well hanged in this life needs to fear no colors.
Make that good.
Many a good hanging prevents a bad marriage.
You're resolute, then?
Not so, neither. But I am resolved on 2 points.
That if one break, the other will hold, or if both break, your pants fall.
Apt. Very apt. Well, go thy way. If Sir Toby would ever leave drinking, thou wert as witty as any a piece of Eve's flesh in Illyria.
Peace, you rogue! No more of that. Here comes my lady. Make your excuse wisely. You were best.
Better a witty fool than a foolish wit.
Oh, God bless thee, my lady! Oh. Take the fool away.
Did you not hear her?
Take away the lady.
Go to. You're a dry fool. Sir, I bade them take away you.
Misprisoned in the highest degree. Oh, good Madonna.
Give me leave to prove you a fool.
Make your proof.
Ah. Good Madonna, why mournest thou?
Good fool, for my brother's death.
I think his soul is in hell, Madonna.
And I know his soul is in heaven, fool.
The more fool, Madonna, to mourn for your brother's soul being in heaven? Oh, take away the fool!
I marvel your ladyship takes delight in such a barren rascal. I saw him put down the other day with an ordinary fool that has no more brain than a stone. Look you now, he's out of his guard already. Unless you laugh and minister occasion to him, he is gagged.
Oh, you are sick of self-love, Malvolio, and taste with a distempered appetite.
Madam, there's at the gate a young gentleman much desirous to speak with you.
From the Count Orsino, is it?
I know not, madam. 'Tis a fair young man. I told him you were sick. He takes it on him to understand so much, and therefore comes to speak with you. I told him you were asleep. He seems to have a foreknowledge of that, too, and therefore comes to speak with you. What is to be said to him, lady? He's fortified against any sort of denial.
What kind of man is he?
Why, of mankind.
No, what manner of man?
A very ill manner. He'll speak with you. Will you or no?
Of what personage and years is he?
Not yet old enough for a man, nor young enough for a boy.
Let him approach. Give me my veil, and come, throw it o'er my face. We'll once more hear Orsino's embassy.
The honorable lady of the house!
Speak to me, I shall answer for her. Your will?
Most radiant, exquisite, and unmatchable beauty!
I pray you, tell me if this be the lady of the house, for I never saw her. I would be loath to cast away my speech, for besides that it is excellently well penned, I have taken great pains to con it. Whence came you, sir?
I can say little more than I have studied, and I'm afraid that question's out of my part. Good gentle one, give me modest assurance, if you be the lady of the house, that I may proceed in my speech.
Are you a comedian?
No! Are you the lady of the house?
If I do not usurp myself, I am.
Oh, this is for my commission. I will on with my speech in your praise and show you the heart of my message.
Come to what is important, and I forgive you the praise.
I have taken great pains to study it, and 'tis poetical.
It is more the like to be feigned. I pray you, keep it in. If ye be not mad, be gone. If ye have reason, be brief.
Will you hoist sail, sir? Here lies your way.
No, good swabber. I am to hull here a bit longer. Some mollification for your giant, sweet lady. Give us the place alone. We will hear this divinity. Now, sir, what is your text?
Most sweet lady!
A comfortable doctrine, and much may be said of it. Where lies your text?
In Orsino's bosom.
In his bosom? In what chapter of his bosom?
Oh, to answer by the method, in the first of his heart.
Oh, I have read it. It is heresy. Have ye no more to say?
Good madam, let me see your face.
Have you any commission from your lord to negotiate with my face? You are now out of your text. But we will draw the curtain and show you the picture.
'Tis beauty truly blent, whose red and white nature's sweet and cunning hand laid on, lady. You are the cruelest she alive, if you will lead these graces to the grave and leave the world no copy.
Were you sent hither to praise me?
My lord and master loves you.
How does he love me?
With adorations, fertile tears, with groans that thunder love, with sighs of fire.
Your lord does know my mind, but I cannot love him. He might have took his answer long ago.
If I did love you, in my master's flame, with such a suffering, such a deadly life, in your denial I would find no sense. I would not understand it.
Why? What would you?
Make me a willow cabin at your gate and call upon my soul within the house. Bellow to the reverberate hills and make the babbling gossip of the air cry out, Olivia! Oh, you should not rest between the elements of air and earth, but you should pity me.
You might do much. What is your parentage?
Above my fortunes, yet my state as well. I am a gentleman.
Get you to your lord. I cannot love him, and let him send no more. Unless you come to me again to tell me how he takes it. Fare thee well. I thank you for your pains. Spend this for me.
Oh, I am no feed post, lady. Keep your purse. My master, not myself, lacks recompense. Love make his heart of flint that you shall love, and let your fervor, like my master's, be placed in contempt. Farewell, fair cruelty.
What is your parentage? Above my fortunes, yet my state is well. I am a gentleman. I'll be sworn thou art. Thy tongue, thy face, thy limbs, actions, and spirit do give thee fivefold blazon. But not too fast. Soft. Soft. Unless the master were the man. How now? Even may one so quickly catch the plague? What ho, Malvolio?
Here, madam, at your service.
Run after that same peevish messenger. He left this ring with him, and tell him I'll know of it. Desire him not to flatter with his lore, nor hold him up with hopes. I am not for him. If the youth will come this way tomorrow, I shall give him reasons for it. Hie thee, Malvolio.
Madam, I will.
I know not what, yet fear to find mine eye too great a flatterer for my mind. Fate, show thy force. Ourselves we do not owe. What is decreed must be. And be this so.
Will you stay no longer? Nor will you not that I go with you?
By your patience, no. My stars shine darkly over me. The malignancy of my fate might perhaps distemper yours. Therefore, I crave of you your leave that I shall bear my evils alone.
Let me yet know of you whither you are bound.
No sooth, sir. My determinate voyage is mere extravagancy. Antonio, my name is Sebastian. My father was that Sebastian of Messaline, whom I know you've heard of. He left behind him, myself, and his sister, both born in an hour. If the heavens had been pleased, we would have so ended, but you, sir, altered that. For some hour before you took me from the breach of the sea was my sister drowned.
Alas, the day.
Lady, sir, though it was said she much resembled me, was yet of many accounted beautiful. She is drowned already, sir, with salt water, though I seem to drown her remembrance again with more.
Pardon me, sir, your bad entertainment.
Oh, good Antonio, forgive me your trouble.
Let me be your servant.
Desire it not. Fare you well. I'm bound to the Count Orsino's court. Farewell.
The gentleness of all the gods go with thee. I have many enemies in Orsino's court, else should I very shortly see thee there. But come what may, I do adore thee so, that danger shall seem sport. And I will go!
Were you not even now with the Countess Olivia?
Even now, sir, on a moderate pace I have since arrived but hither.
She returns this ring to you, sir. You might have saved me my pains to have taken it away yourself. She adds, moreover, that you should put your lord into a desperate assurance that she will none of him.
She took the ring of me. I'll none of it.
Oh, come, sir, you peevishly threw it to her. And her will is, it should be so returned. If it be worth stooping for, there it lies, in your eye. If not, be it his that finds it.
I left no ring with her. What means this lady? Fortune forbid my outside have not charmed her. She made good view of me, indeed so much that sure methought her eyes had lost her tongue, for she did speak in starts distractedly. She loves me. Sure, the cunning of her passion invites me in this churlish messenger. None of my lord's ring. Why, he sent her none. I am the man, if it be so, as 'tis. Poor lady, she were better love a dream. My master loves her dearly, and I, poor monster, fond as much on him, and she, mistaken, seems to dote on me. What will become of this? Oh, time, thou must untangle this, not I. It is too hard a knot for me to untie.
Approach, Sir Andrew, not to be abed after midnight is to be up betimes.
Nay, my troth, I know not, but to be up late is to be up late.
Thou art a scholar. Let us therefore eat and drink. Marry, and I say, a stoup of wine.
Here comes the fool in faith.
Oh, how now, my hearts? Did you never see the picture of we three?
Come, there is sixpence for you. Let's have a song.
There's a testrel of me, too. One night giver.
Would you have a song of good love or a song of good life?
Oh, a love song. A love song.
Aye, aye. I care not for good life.
Oh, mistress mine, where are you roaming? Oh, stay and hear your true love's coming, that can sing both high and low. Trip no further, pretty sweeting, journey's end in lovers meeting. Every wise man's son doth know. Oh, mwah!
Mwah! Excellent. Good.
Good. Good.
Mellifluous voice, says I am a true knight.
Well, a contagious breath.
Very sweet and contagious, in faith.
To hear by the nose, it is dulcet and contagious. But shall we make the welcome dance, indeed? Shall we rouse the night owl in a catch that will draw three souls from one weaver? Shall we do that?
And you love me, let's do it. I'm dog at catch.
Oh, by your lady, sir, and some dogs may catch well.
knew of Malvolio and bid him trotted out of doors. Never trust me!
We are politicians. Malvolio's a Pegarangi and a three merry men be we. Am not I consanguineous? Am I not of her blood? Tilly Valley, lady. There dwelt a man in
Babble.
Oh, lady.
Light and admirable.
On the 12th night of.
Burgasters! Are you mad? Or what are you? Have you no wit, manners, nor honesty but to gabble like tinkers at this time of night? Do you make an alehouse of my lady's house? Is there no respect of place, persons, nor time in you?
Oh, well, we did keep time, sir, in our catches. Snack up.
Sir Toby, I must be round with you.
Hey.
My lady bade me tell you that, though she harbors you as her kinsman, she's nothing allied to your disorders. If you can separate yourself and your misdemeanors, you are welcome to the house. If not, and it would please you to take leave of her, she is very willing to bid you farewell.
Farewell. Farewell.
Farewell, dear heart, since I must needs be gone!
His eyes you show, his days are almost done!
Is it even so?
But I will never die. Out of tune, sir, ye lie. Art any more than a steward? Or dost thou think, because thou art virtuous, there shall be no more cakes and ale? A stoup of wine, Maria.
Mistress Mary! If you prized my lady's favor at anything more than contempt, you would not give means for this uncivil rule. She shall know of it by this hand.
Go shake your ears!
'Twere good indeed as to drink when a man's hungry, as to challenge him the field, and then to break promise with him and make a fool of him.
Oh, do it, knight. I'll write thee a challenge, or I'll deliver thy indignation with him by a word of mouth.
Sweet Sir Toby, be patient for tonight, for the best persuaded of himself, so crammed as he thinks, with excellencies that it is his grounds of faith that all that look on him love him. Mwah. And on that vice in him will my revenge find notable cause to work.
What wilt thou do?
I will drop in his way some obscure excellence of love wherein by the color of his beard, shape of his leg, manner of his gait, expression of his eye, forehead, and complexion, he shall find himself most feelingly persuaded. I can ride very like my lady, your niece. On a forgotten matter, we can hardly make distinction of our hands.
Excellent, I smell a device.
I have it in my nose too.
He shall think by the notes that thou will drop that they come from my niece Olivia, and that she is in love with him.
My purpose is indeed a horse of that color.
And your horse now would make him an ass.
I will plant you two, and let the fool make a third where he shall find a letter. Observe his construction of it. But this night, to bed, and dream on the event. Farewell.
Before me, she's a good wench.
She's a beagle, true bred, and one that adores me. What of that?
I was adored once, too.
Let's to bed, knight. Thou hast need send for more money.
If I cannot recover your niece, I'm a foul way out.
Send for money, knight. If thou hast her not in the end, call me cut.
If I do not, never trust me. Take it how you will.
Come, come. I'll go burn some sack. 'Tis too late to go to bed now. Come, knight. Come, knight! Come on!
Ha
give me some music. Now, good morrow, friends, now good Cesario, but that song, that old and antique song we heard last night, methought it did relieve my passion much, come but one verse.
He is not here, so please, your lordship, that should sing it.
Who was it?
Feste, my lord, he is about the house.
Seek him out and play the tune a while. Come hither, boy. If ever thou shalt love in the sweet pangs of it, remember me. How dost thou like this tune?
It gives a very echo to the seat where love is throned.
Thou dost speak masterly my life upon it. Young though thine art, thine eye hath stayed upon some favor that it loves. Hath it not, boy?
A little, by your favor.
What kind of woman is it?
Of your complexion, my lord.
She is not worthy, then. What years in faith?
About your years, my lord.
Too old by heaven. Let thy love be younger than thyself, or thy affection cannot hold the bent. For women are as roses, whose fair flower, being once displayed, doth fall that very hour.
And so they are, alas, that they are so. To die, even when they to perfection grow.
Ah, boy, come. That song we heard last night. Mark it, Cesario, for it is old and plain, and dallies with the innocence of love like the old age.
Are you ready, sir?
Aye, prithee sing.
Come away, death, and in sad cypress let me be laid. Fly away, I am slain by a cruel fair maid. My shroud of white stuck all with you. Oh, prepare it, my part of death, no one so true did share it.
There's for thy pain.
Oh, no pain, sir. I take pleasure in singing, sir.
I'll pay thy pleasure, then. Give me now leave to leave thee.
Now, may the melancholy god protect thee. Fare thee well, sir.
Once more, Cesario, get thee to yon same sovereign cruelty. Tell her my love more noble than the world. Prize is not quantity of dirty lands, and that I hold as giddily as fortune.
But if she cannot love you, sir?
I cannot be so answered.
Sooth, but you must say that some lady, as perhaps there is, hath for your love a greater pang of heart as you have for Olivia. You cannot love her. You tell her so. Must she not then be answered?
There's no woman's sides can bide the beating of so strong a passion as love doth give my heart. Make no compare between the love a woman can bear me and the love that I owe for Olivia.
Aye, but I know that...
What dost thou know?
Too well what love women to men may owe. In faith they are as true as heart as you, as we. My father had a daughter loved a man, as it might be, perhaps, were I a woman, I should your lordship.
And what's her history?
A blank, my lord. She never told her love, but let concealment, like a worm in the bud, feed on her damask cheek. She pined and thought, and with a green and yellow melancholy, sat like patience on a monument, smiling at grief.
But died thy sister of her love, my boy?
I am all the daughters of my father's house. And all the brothers, too, and yet I know not. Sir, shall I to the sleep?
Aye, that's the theme. To her in haste, give her this jewel. Tell her my love can give no place, bide no delay.
Well, of this sport, let me be boiled to death with melancholy. You know, he brought me out of favor with my lady about a bear baiting here.
To anger him, we'll have the bear again, and we will fool him black and blue, shall we not, Sir Andrew?
If we do not, 'tis the pity of our lives.
Here comes the little villain. How now, my medal of India?
Malvolio's coming down this walk. He has been yonder in the sun, practicing behavior to his own shadow this half hour. Observe him for the love of mockery, for I know this letter will make a contemplative idiot of him. Close in the name of jesting. Lie out there, for here comes the trap that must be caught tickling.
Tis but fortune. All is fortune. Maria once told me Olivia did affect me, and I have heard herself come thus close that, should she fancy, it should be one of my complexion. What should I think of it?
Here's an overweening rogue.
Contemplation makes a rare turkey cock of him. See how he jets under his advanced plumes.
Slight, I could so beat the rogue.
Peace, I say.
To be Count Malvolia.
Pistol him! Pistol him!
Peace! That was deeply in. See how imagination blows him.
Having been 3 months married to her, sitting in my state.
For a stone bow to hit him in the eye.
Calling my officers about me in my branched velvet gown. Having come from a daybed where I have left Olivia sleeping.
Fire and brimstone!
Now, peace, peace.
Sir Toby approaches, curtsies there to me.
Bolts and shackles!
I extend my hand to him thus, saying, Cousin Toby, my fortunes having cast me on your niece, give me this prerogative of speech.
What?
You must amend your drunkenness.
Outstanding!
Nay, patience! We break the sinews of our plot.
Besides, you waste the treasure of your time with a foolish knight.
That's me, I warrant you.
One, Sir Andrew.
I knew 'twas I, for many do call me fool.
What employment have we here?
Now is the woodcock near the gin.
Peace and the spirit of humor, intimate reading aloud to him.
By my life, this is my lady's hand. These be her very C's, her U's, and her T's, and thus makes she her great P's.
Her C's, her U's, and her T's? Why that?
To the unknown beloved, this and my good wishes. Her very phrases. By your leave, wax. Soft, it is my lady. To whom should this be?
This one's of liver and all.
Jove knows I love, but who? Lips do not move. No man must know. No man must know. What follows? If this should be thee, Malvolio.
Mary, hang thee, bride.
I may command where I adore, but silence, like a Lucrece knife, with bloodless stroke my heart doth gore. M-O-A-I doth sway my life.
A Faustian riddle.
Excellent wench, say I.
M-O-A-I doth sway my life? Nay, but first, let me see. I may command where I adore. Why? She may command me. I serve her. She is my lady! There is no obstruction in this! Oh, in the end, what should that alphabetical position portend? If only I could make it resemble something in me. Softly. M-O-A-I.
Malvolio!
M. Why, that begins my name!
Did not I say he would work it out?
M. Then there's no consonancy in the sequel. M-O-A-I. The simulation is not as the former. Yet, to crush this a little, it would bow to me, for every one of these letters are in my name. Soft, here follows prose. In my stars I am above thee, but be not afraid of greatness. Some are born great, some achieve greatness, and some have greatness thrust upon them. Be opposite with a kinsman, surly with servants. Remember who commended thy yellow stockings and wished to see thee ever cross-gartered. I say, remember, go to. Thou art made, if thou desirest to be so. And if not, let me see thee a steward still, the fellow of servants, not worthy to touch fortune's fingers. Farewell. She that would alter services with thee, the fortunate unhappy. I will be proud. I will baffle Sir Toby. I will wash off gross acquaintance. My lady loves me.
She did commend my yellow stockings of late, and she did praise my leg being cross-gartered, and in this, she manifests herself to my love, and with a kind of injunction, drives me to these habits of her liking. I thank my stars I am happy. I will be strange.
Strange.
Stout. In yellow stockings, and cross-gartered. Jove and my stars be praised. Oh, and here's the postscript. If thou entertainest my love, let it appear in thy smiling. Thy smiles become thee well. Therefore, in my presence, still smile, I prithee. Jove, I thank thee. I will smile. I will do everything that thou wilt have me.
Come, it's all right. Come.
Oh, I could marry this wench for this device.
So could I, too.
And ask no other dowry with her but such another jest.
Nor I, neither.
Ah, here comes my noble gall catcher.
Wilt thou set thy foot upon my neck?
Or on mine, either?
Shall I play my freedom at K-trip and become thy bond slave?
Or I, either?
Then nay, but say true, does it work upon him?
Like aquavitae on a midway.
He will come to her in yellow stockings, and 'tis a color she abhors, and cross-gartered, a fashion she detests. And he will smile upon her, which will now be so unsuitable to her disposition, being addicted to a melancholy as she is, that I cannot but drive him into notable contempt. If you will see it, follow me.
To the gates of Tartar, thou most excellent devil of wit.
I'll make one too.
Save thee, friend, and thy music. Dost thou live by thy drum?
Oh, no, sir. I live by the church.
Art thou a churchman?
No such matter, sir. I do live by the church, for I do live at my house, and my house doth stand by the church.
So thou mayest say. The king lies by a beggar, if a beggar dwell near him, or the church lies by thy drum, if thy drum stand by thy church.
Oh, to see this good age, a sentence is but a chevral glove to a good wit. How quickly the wrong side may be turned outward.
Art thou not the Lady Olivia's fool?
Oh, no, sir. The Lady Olivia has no fool. She will keep no fool, sir, till she be married. I am not her fool, but her corrupter of words.
I'll no more with thee.
Oh. Oh. No!
There's expenses for thee.
Oh, now Jove and his next commodity of hair. Send thee a beard.
By my troth, I'll tell thee I am almost sick for one. Is thy lady within?
Oh, my lady is within, sir. I will construe to her whence you come. Who you are and what you are out of my welcome. I would say element, but the word is overworn.
This fellow is wise enough to play the fool, and to do that craves a kind of wit.
Oh, gentlemen, God save thee.
And you, sir.
Dieu vous garde, monsieur.
Et vous aussi, votre serviteur.
I hope, sir, you are, and I am yours.
Oof. Will you encounter the house? My niece is desirous you should enter if your trade be to her.
I am bound to your niece, sir. I mean, she is the list of my voyage.
Taste your legs, sir. Put them to motion.
The excellent accomplished lady, the heavens raid odors upon thee.
Let the garden door be shut and leave me to my hearing. Give me your hand, sir.
My duty, madam, and most humble service.
What's your name?
Cesario is your servant's name, fair princess.
My servant, sir. You're the servant to the Count Orsino.
And he is yours, and his must needs be yours. Your servant's servant is your servant, madam. Madam, I come to want your gentle thoughts on his behalf.
Oh, by our leave, I pray you. I bade you never speak again of him.
Dear lady.
Give me leave, beseech you. I did send, after the last enchantment you did hear, a ring in chase of you. So did I abuse myself and my servant, and I fear me, you. What might you think? So, let me hear you speak.
I pity you.
That's a degree to love.
No, not a grise. Very oft we pity enemies.
How apt the poor are to be proud. Be not afraid, good youth. I will not have you. There lies your way. Due west.
Then westward ho. Grace and good disposition attend your ladyship.
Stay. 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 Tell me what thou thinkest of me.
That you do think you are not what you are.
If I think so, I think the same of you.
Then you are right. I am not what I am.
I would you were, as I would have you be.
Would it be better, madam, than I am? I wish it were, for now I am your fool.
Oh, what deal of scorn looks beautiful in the contempt and anger of his lips. Oh, Cesario, by the roses of spring, by maidenhood, honor, truth, and everything, I love thee so. That maugre all thy pride, nor wit nor reason can my passion hide.
By innocence, I swear, and by my youth, I have one heart, one bosom, and one truth, and no woman has, nor never none shall be mistress of it save I alone. And so of you, good madam, nevermore will I my master's tears to you deplore.
Yet come again! For perhaps thou mayest move that heart, which now abhors to like his love.